time now for the Fuso starting grid, and it reveals to us that Jamie Wincup, the reigning champion and the series leader, has got the pole alongside his old rival Mark Winterbottom. Holden versus Ford, then it's Craig Lowndes alongside Todd Kelly. Those two have had some great battles over the year. 200th event start for Todd, congratulations. His teammate Michael Caruso next. Rick Kelly is alongside him. A lot of Nissan action. Nick Percat spoke to him, starting seventh. He's alongside Garth Tander, the fast finisher in that last one. From Scott McLaughlin, the winner of race number 33, with David Reynolds alongside him, then the Bathurst champion, Chaz Mostert. James Courtney, who's still got a little bit of work to do to get that car to his liking. Jason Bright from 13, then Will Davison. We had a word to him on the starting grid. James Moffat, who got turned around at turn six in that last one with Scott Pye, Wilson Security Racing, then Jack Perkins from 17, Russell Ingall from 18, Ford versus Holden, Dale Wood and Robert Dahlgren. Robert described his car to me earlier in the day, so just snapping in the rear at the worst time, very uncomfortable for him. Tim Slade, Super Cheap Auto Racing, Lee Holdsworth for Erebus, and if you didn't catch the news, he's departing and moving to Charlie Schwerkholt's team, taking Jack Perkins' seat. And then Fabian Coulthard didn't even get out for qualifying for race number 34 because of the damage when he and Shane Van Gisbergen got together earlier in the day, and Van Gisbergen starts out of position really down there in number 24 as well. So there are a couple of things to keep an eye on. This intense battle at the front row of the grid, and then that batch of Nissans that are looking for supremacy, together with one or two very fast guys, including Shane Van Gisbergen and Fabian Coulthard at the back. As Gafi said before, we've got a total of 9 cars with onboard cameras, and cameras in all corners of those vehicles as well, to try and give us as much information as we can. I made a promise to you earlier about listening to the beautiful sound of that Volvo, so try and deliver on that if we can. So looking forward to this one. So a couple of, it's a really good grid, Scafie, because when you look at the lineup here, there's going to be some great battles. And I think McLaughlin, winner from the last race, he's got a bit of work to do. And this will just demonstrate whether or not, when he tries to use a bit more of the car and a little bit more of the tyre, whether it's capable of delivering. Tander's got a bit of work to do as well. He went very well in that last one. It just goes to show you, from qualifying to qualifying, when they're back-to-back, as they are, and just 10 minutes in duration, you can get a really varied result. And so it's scrambled this grid. But we've got the key men at the front of it. And that was a nice recovery by Wincup in qualifying, because they smartened the car up a lot between qualifying 33 and 34. Changed it a lot. I think the grip level changed a little bit. And there's, for this race, you can see it down towards the south and southwest there, the right-hand top right-hand corner of your screen. It's just beginning to get a little bit brighter than it's been all day.
And Neil, such an important start this one. We've had quite a bit of UV light around today. Not a lot of temperature, but we certainly have track temperature. Because this is such a long lap around, the guys have had plenty of opportunity to get heat into their tyres. Now remember, they'll have a throttle percentage position on their dash. They'll have a line lock and stop the car rolling. There's a lot of heat in their tyres. They're going to have to get just the right amount of wheel spin, because remember, one of these guys are going to have to get the jump, because you do not want to be stuck on the outside for turn two. There it is, right there in front of you, the 2015 V8 Supercar Championship combatants, right there.
So Wincup in one, Winterbottom in five. Both of them as far forward as they dare.
It's a very hard place to get them off the line.
Lowndes and Todd Kelly, row two. Two more distance, row three. Plus Fitness, Phillip Island 400, race number 34 underway. An ordinary start for Rick Kelly. Garth Tander made a good jump. So did Mark Winterbottom. Winterbottom is trying to close the margin, close down, and he does. They're three wide with Tander on the outside into one. He had to yield. And Todd Kelly holds on.
Great job. That was a very good start between Winterbottom and Wincup. And they played gamesmanship the whole way down into turn one. Finally, Winterbottom moved across. Now we've got some bump and grind with McLaughlin and Percat. This is very, very close. Oh, check the oversteer. Check the slide through turn three.
And Nick actually grabbed the brake mid-corner there to steady it down. Tim Slade's on the outside at four. There's always bump and grind here. Cold tyres, cold brakes, opening lap. A lot of congestion, mid-pack. Tander's got it all going on. He's got a wall of cars around and behind him. Caruso is having a huge battle here with McLaughlin. McLaughlin's on the outside in the grey. He had to yield. He had to flick the throttle up and tuck back in behind, or he would run out of road in a hurry. He's vulnerable over the top of the hill here because Perkat's looking, and so is Rick Kelly. Look at this, they're everywhere. Do you look in the mirror? Do you look left? Do you look right? Or do you focus on the race line? Well, the truth is you've got to do all of the above, and Reynolds made contact with the Nissan there in turn 11 with Rick Kelly. So there's a little bit of a brush of contact there and a contact again. So that's like the third time that those guys have got together.
And the reason I'm gasping, that's 200 kilometres an hour when he was right out sideways. There was some tyre smoke there off the side of Dave Reynolds. Look at this. This is Rick Kelly trying to get a run down the inside into turn one. 285k on the approach into there. Slightly wide. Oh, just stayed on there. A little brush with the grass. And now Reynolds down the inside of Kelly. He's going to push him wide. Mostert trying to get into the back of that battle also. Wow, that's an unbelievably frantic first lap. This is not over. Check this out.
And Rick having a look to see whether he can position to get down the inside at four. He might have done it. He might be able to grab this. And, of course, there's big variance in the starting pressures for some of these guys as well. And that can sometimes explain the difference in performance together with the tyre condition and how they choose to roll out here. Because they've got to do a long race tomorrow. I was hoping in the pit walk to be able to show you some tyres with different tread depths. They start with a little less than 4 millimetres of tread depth. Oh, Perkat on the outside. Oh. This is from the front bumper of James Courtney's car at Hayshed.
That was very brave.
And Nick held on.
You don't normally get around the outside there and stay on the black stuff.
So he's 11th now in triple two. There's Van Gisbergen and Coulthard trying to work their way forward. They're 19th and 20th, and more smoke, more contact. Mid-pack's crazy. Oh. Here's Courtney.
Seriously?
14th at the moment. That's Will Davison and Jack Perkins.
That would be one of the wildest opening couple of laps that I've ever seen at Phillip Island. That really good quality driving and a lot of guys very close to each other. Check this out. Jack Perkins down the inside just has to sneak back in.
Michael Caruso, fastest lap of the race in the Norton Nissan, 1 minute 33.4. Van Gisbergen tries to go the high line at two. He's trying to round up Russell Ingall here. They're in behind Jason Bright. And he's made that work. Well, he just dropped it off the edge briefly. Russell will need to be kind to him down here because if you've got the nose underneath him at the corner, it makes it awkward. Similarly down here at turn four, Tander's working. Todd Kelly. And now he's on the outside when they get to six at Siberia. And if you can stay there, you end up ideally lined up for Hayshed, but he's not quite there yet. This is tense. Tander and Kelly side by side. And Todd's in the grey, doesn't want to yield, fights every last little millimetre. Oh. And how Todd Kelly didn't end up off the road there is a miracle. And
it's still on each other. Bump and push there, pushed him wide. Agartha returned serve here. He didn't get quite up enough at turn 11 to do it. But Todd, that was out of the hay shed, getting to Lukey Heights, as close as you would ever have, a 240k accident. Then they got themselves over the hill. And then their radio chat is going off from both of them because they come over the hill. He gets a little bump, pushes him wide, and then flicks the other way. That's Perkins now, right out in the weeds, coming onto the main straight. He's lost about seven or eight spots.
No surprise that Garth got on the radio. Change for position here. Windcomers grab Winterbottom. So that was at turn two. So no surprise that Tander was a bit animated after that. He was very lucky to save that car over the top of the hill. That will have raised eyebrows in race control. And whether or not it's regarded as a bump and run or all's fair in love and war remains to be seen. We'll hear from them, no doubt.
So, that's Courtney with Davison. There was bumping there before. It's a replay, Gillette Max 3 replay of that. And here we go, in behind Perkat. That's on board with James Courtney, and that shows that contact. And then one of the Nissans, I think it's Moffat, actually sneaks by. Check this out. This is over the hill. There's not much in that,
no,
crop. It's hard
that
to pick that one. It's a racing incident, I reckon. It's one of those ones. He doesn't know where he is. And finally, they make contact and pushed him wide. Now, there may have been a little bit of a bump there with Jason Brunt. I'm not sure either. So, Jack Perkins right out And here we go. This is the spot that we captured Wink Cup making the move on Winterbottom for the lead and potentially championship changing move, that one, because if Wink Cup beats Winterbottom in this race, he has a greater than 450 point lead, he will win.
Puzzled by how Jamie was able to do that, so I wonder whether there was something happened to Frosty through one or the early part of two to allow that to occur, for those positions to change. But wow, that was an eventful first couple of laps, wasn't it? Particularly when you look through all those replays. But I agree with you in the Tander Todd Kelly incident at the top of the hill, very hard. That's one of those that you need to go through frame by frame. And it may well be argued that Garth was trying to get back to the left. Once he put some angle on the car, that created the contact. I need to look at it a few times, but it's one that they'll all no doubt have personal points of view on afterwards. So now here's the replay through one. Yeah, Frosty went in too deep, so he was wide and slow off one. That then made the invitation perfect for Jamie in two, and that's the explanation. That's the full explanation as to what's happened down there. So you get an understanding there of how Jamie Wincup was able to do that. So second time today that Winterbottom's found himself a little bit hot into one. He has paid the price. Incidentally, Lowndes has now gone through to second. So Red Bull now one and two. Frosty's gone back to third. So Wincup, Lowndes, Winterbottom and Tander. We'll take a break. Be back. He's hitting his targets, Jamie Wincup. Fastest lap of the race, 1 minute 33.3. And he's got a margin of 1.6 seconds now over Craig Lowndes. But down the order in this field, elbows are up, paint is flying. We're looking at Shane Van Gisbergen here. He's now in 15th position between Scott Pye and Will Davison. He's made pretty good ground. And it's all going on left, right and centre. There are people pushing and shoving everywhere at the moment. And just looking at those who've made gains and others who've had the losses. Here's Garth Tander, by the way, getting it wrong down at turn one. That's been a popular error today. And it's because Garth said to me yesterday, you won't believe how far that we're pushing into turn one at the moment. Just with the resurfaced track last year, the tyre grip that's being offered, a little bit of headwind down there. So we're braking so far down there compared to yesteryear. I reckon it's creating a few issues. See, it stepped in the rear in the early part of that corner, once they come unglued down there, a little bit hard to ride it.
Caruso did a really good job because he gave him room to get back on the track. Under normal circumstances, Caruso doesn't have to do that. This is another moment there for Jack Perkins. Oh, that was super close with David Wall. Now, I don't know whether he gets it. He does get out. He's able to get in there so far that he can basically get through the back of the sand trap with just momentum. And that was a big moment for Wincup. Wincup almost went off then. He didn't lock a wheel, but he braked. The road falls away from you there at Southern Loop. There's two apexes. And when he turned the wheel, he couldn't get it slowed down. He almost went off the road where we saw Jack Perkins a second ago. So, I mean, you see this sort of racing on street circuits. At the Gold Coast, you see the hustle and bustle of this sort of stuff. This is the hay shed. But you don't see that sort of stuff at Phillip Island Cropper.
No.
I mean, it's playing for keeps, going fast, seriously fast.
He looked at me in the break and laughed. He said, this is a crazy race. And that's exactly what it is at the moment. It's just, it's quite an amazing amount of stuff going on out there. So 33-1, fastest lap of the race for Wincup. He's got 1.4 seconds now. He lost a little bit of time with that mistake at turn two. Here's Todd Kelly working hard in that battle with Garth Tander, and Tim Slade's gone off the road. I think that's with one of the Erebus cars. Is it Will Davison? We'll just have to... It might be Lee Holdsworth, I reckon. I think Will's further up the road in that battle with James Courtney. He's got steering damage on that front left corner for Slade. Massive steering arm damage. You'll need to limp that car carefully back round this lap. It'll be tugging on the steering wheel for him. And he's slowed it right off now. I think both front wheels actually looking a bit sad there at the moment. So he's rolled out of it. So he and Jack Perkins have had a tough run. They're good friends. It's Jack behind him at the moment. So they're second last and last in the field. So here's what happened. Yeah, it was Lee. So contact there. Couldn't stop it. Wheel-to-wheel contact. And it's bent the steering arm on the Holden. Coulthard, meantime, is 18th. Van Gisbergen is 15th. This is the battle for fourth at the moment between Todd Kelly and Garth Tander. These fellas are about 5 seconds off the lead of the race. And the gap, incidentally, between Wincup and Lowndes has narrowed up now to 1 second.
Todd Kelly's done a great job. He's on target for the best result in 3 years as we see Garth Tander. Little commentary curse then, Croppo, just giving him a super rap. And he leaves a little hole down there at MG. Tander fires down the inside. Now McLaughlin right behind. Check the body language out. Now, why don't we stay and listen to this Volvo that Neil promised? But while you do it, have a look how much the slide and body language of the Altima makes an unbelievable... There's a little spit of rain just there. A little bit of water on the windscreen just a second ago there. Have a listen. This is fantastic. Spits of rain. Total different lines. Huge amount of oversteer then.
Oversteer, and that's what he's telling Richard Holway at the moment, Scott McLaughlin, which means the back of the thing's just too lively. And we saw evidence of it as Tim Slade comes in to attend to that steering arm. It's sliding over the top of the hill, and he was a bit vulnerable to that earlier in the race earlier today as well. Take a break. Back soon. Started on pole position, Jamie Wincup, and he leads this race. He's done the fastest lap of the race as well. He's got a 1.66 second margin over his teammate, Craig Lowndes, who's playing tail gunner at the moment. And then Mark Winterbottom, who started strong early on, is in third place and looking reasonably solid at the moment from Garth Tander, Todd Kelly, Scott McLaughlin, Michael Crusoe. That's far from resolved.
A very special guest in the Red Bull garage. The head of motorsport for Red Bull Worldwide, Thomas Alberall, joins us. Thomas, great to have you here. Your impressions, I know you haven't been to Phillip Island before, but your impressions about championship here?
Yeah, it's very good. It's a nice championship. It's great racing. Yeah, you don't see this so often, and it's really fighting man to man, and this is really what we like. And especially now, it looks really great for Jamie, you know, that if everything goes out like this, he might secure the championship today.
You did pick the right day to come, didn't you? He looks pretty good right now.
Yeah, I just spoke to Roland earlier, and he said, well, the last race I was joining, it was, I think, last year at the Gold Coast, they also were winning, and so it seems I bring a little bit of luck from Austria to here.
You certainly have. They have been an outstanding team this year.
But say again?
They have been an outstanding team, Roland and his boys.
Yes, so all the time since we were with them, I mean, we really like it, and we know they are so competitive and so professional. Everyone in the team is so motivated, and it's really just nice to work with them and to be a partner as we are. Yes.
Thomas, it's great to have you here. We'll let you sit back and enjoy this moment.
Thank you.
And it's a special moment for Red Bull Racing Australia and their worldwide motorsport programs. We've got a lot of activities, and this is one of the best. Wincup and Lowndes, they've got control of it at the moment. We'll take our final break, come back and wrap it all up shortly. back at Phillip Island for the Plus Fitness Phillip Island 400. Race 34, the second of the super sprint races today. On screen here is Dale Wood, Advam and GB Galvanising. This car had a livery change a few race meetings back. Remember, he had that fantastic third place in the seventh race of the championship back at Winton. He had a bit of an up and down year. But this fellow was the Dunlop Series champion of last year. What this does, Scafie, is it always underscores for me just how hard it is to make it in the main game. And when you talk to Dale, he's the first one to admit it, it steps up a level. But you're laying the foundation. You come out of a phase in your career where you've won races and you get to a point, you get into the primary field, and then you take a hit. It's a snakes and ladders game. You go back down the snake, and then you start to wind up the ladder again. And typically those that have won a Dunlop Series find their way in the end. You know, guys that have done very well in it, the fellas like Mostert and Percat, and going all the way back to Umbrell, and a whole variety of people that have done well in it over the years, Andrew Jones, you see them climb up. So it's good to see him out there and circulating strongly at the moment. Wincup and Lowndes still in command here, 1.1 seconds. They're in a cruise. They're looking pretty comfortable. It's a bit of a gap then back to Mark Winterbottom. And there's several little angry packs all boxing on here at the moment. So Reynolds is 12th. This is Courtney on board over his left shoulder. And Courtney and Will Davis, and we're at it before. So the 12th, 13th, 14th is the focus here at the moment. Pretty much in the midfield. This is Hayshed, Mark's favourite corner. You hear that big throttle percentage change there for Courtney. Has to come out of the throttle as the tyre condition goes away. That little mid-corner reset there for James because it's pushing too much in the nose. And then even as he picked the throttle up and the car goes light over the top of the hill, it slides in the rear. So it's a real dance of hands and feet here, Rihanna.
Scotty Sinclair, race director here at Nissan Motorsport. Nissan, all four cars are really coming on strong here this weekend, but it's not just this weekend. The last few races, Nissan really have had some great pace.
Yeah, we're going all right at the moment. It's good. All four Altimas in the top 11 now. We were in the 10 a minute ago, but yeah, it's great. We're on the improve. You know, we've still got a lot of work to do and some improvements in the car to come, but it's good. It's good to have the Altimas up there and competitive with the other guys.
Is there something in particular that you can put it down to? Is it just a combination of development that's happened across the year?
Yeah, it's just a lot of little things, really. Yeah, there's no magic bullet. We all know that. So it's just a lot of little things that's slowly coming together for us. So the guys are doing a good job.
Great to see. Thanks, Scott.
Thanks.
Adrian Burgess, another bloke doing a good job, or a great team effort down here, mate. Your car's quick, Garth Tander in particular, up into fourth position again. I think we can expect a lot from tomorrow. Qualifying, probably not how you want it, Adrian, but gee, good car pace, good race pace.
Oh, you summed it up well yourself there. We didn't qualify anywhere near where we should have done. GT's doing a cracking job. Just can't start in the middle and expect to win races. So, yeah, we'll give it a tune-up tonight and hopefully qualify better and then race, you know, off the back of that tomorrow.
All right, thanks, mate. Best luck in qualifying tomorrow.
Cheers, mate. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a very good summary. Mark Larkham catching up there with Adrian Burgess. You've got to start towards the front of this place. It's so fast. You can't be in the dirty air. We're on board now with Scott Pye. This is a great shot. Looking down at Scott working. That looks like he's at MG. It's now turn 11. And then he'll be coming out onto the straight at turn 12. And that is such a beautiful, flowing, high-speed corner in fourth gear. If you've got a tailwind, it's actually fifth gear. If you've got a headwind, it's fourth gear. And the tail or headwind makes about 15k difference down the end of this straight. So we've been talking 285. As you can see there, it made 277. So that today, the wind is coming off the water, effectively a southerly, and that knocks a huge amount of terminal speed out of the cars as we're now in southern loop. And we come down to this amazingly fast left-hander.
And down there at turn two, it's always a corner. I don't think it matters how many times you approach it. You never ever break the temptation to pick the throttle up too early.
That's right.
You always feel as though you need to get on with it, and every time you do, you get punished. You've got to be patient through there. It was interesting in that interview that Rihanna did a moment ago with Scott Sinclair to just look at where the Nissan boys are at, Scafie, 5th, 7th, 8th and 11th. Consider it's year two for them as Jason Bright and Shane Van Gisbergen go on with it here in 15th and 16th. But year two in their development phase. And for Volvo, the first year, and Scotty McLaughlin sixth at the moment, first in that earlier race. So it doesn't matter how you look at it, they have made solid ground, both of those outfits, over the last 2 years. And Erebus also won at Winton.
100%. Oh, big lock the rears. That was a mistake from Shane. He locked the rears, but he's actually hung on the inside now for turn 11. He's going to push Jason Bright wide. Scott Pye is going to be the benefactor because he'll get down the inside. He does. So does Fabian. So Jason Bright looked like he made a move and got by Van Gisbergen after the mistake at MG, and he effectively lost three positions at the end of that exchange. So Pye now just trying to get a run down the inside. It does actually have an aero effect when you're right in behind the car that's leading. So this is the replay. Gillette Mach 3 replay of Van Gisbergen. Locks the rears, runs wide, gets it turned in. Finally, holds track position, did a good job to do that. And this is the spot. Corner's always been called MG. Then up to turn 11, holds the inside. Great camera shot from our chopper to show you what happened. And then as Bright got wide, Pye went by, and so did his teammate, Fabian Coulthard. So, as I said, Jason was going to make a spot, and he ended up losing three.
He gets savaged by the pack.
Yeah.
So here's McLaughlin. That's the rear bumper at the moment of the Todd Kelly car, number 7, Jack Daniels entry. And Todd's come off season best qualifying and likely for a season best result in this one. He's under some threat here at the moment. He's got a bunch of his own teammates just tucked in behind here as well.
See those different styles. You've made the point before in the break that McLaughlin's very Lowndes-esque. He turns the car at the corner early. Todd Kelly is almost the total opposite. He turns very late and turns down to make the apex, the inside clipping point, very late in the corner. This is a good example of it. You can see here, he runs it in. Just run a little bit wide that time, Todd Kelly. Just lost a little bit of mid-corner speed, and that's what Neil was also saying. Getting on the throttle here is always important.
And the place on this racetrack where it's extremely evident, Richard Holway. It's not so much this right-hander, but have a look at the next left-hander, the one we call Siberia. Turn 5 is a nothing burger because there's just a kink in the road. But 6 is a full-blown corner. So have a look at the difference for McLaughlin here. See how he dives in. That's exactly what Craig Lowndes does. Dives to the apex. Todd still hasn't connected with it. In fact, he didn't in the end, but he was going to have that little kissing point very late in the corner. So it's a huge difference in the way they go about the craft.
One,
and actually Scott's changed his approach to Hayshed just in these last few laps. He was rushing at it a little earlier, but I reckon he's had a tweak of the bars in the car and also changed his mental approach to it. He comes out of the throttle a little bit earlier and then accelerates through it rather than just pitching the car in there and heavily loading the front left tyre.
Well, you always think you're going to have a moment. You always think you're going to run wide. So that's the championship synopsis for you. 461 points as they stand. Wing Cup currently leading. Winterbottom in third position on track. 450 points on offer. From tomorrow onwards, there are only 451 points between the final part of the Plus Fitness Phillip Island 400 and our next event in Sydney. So if he finishes as they are, he'll win the championship this afternoon.
So those gentlemen that were on screen there a moment ago, Mark Dutton, who's now team manager, and Dave Couchy, who's this man's engineer, Jamie Wincup, that's a reversal. So forever, basically the entire history of the relationship at 888 Race Engineering, Jamie's worked with Mark Dutton. And then they restructured the team when Adrian Burgess left and went to the Holden Racing team. And it took a little time for Jamie to fully come to terms with the new language, the new relationship, and that innate understanding that the two of them require. And now it's working very, very well and very consistent. And that's been the hallmark of his game.
Did you see that?
Yeah.
I mean, that graphic, his fastest lap was lap 20. So he did 10, 11 and 20 as the three fastest laps. That's, you're watching, and I know we make a lot of this, the ltsc.com.au graphic shows it there, but if you have a look at that and you go 32.9, 32.9, 33 dead, we're watching one of the best operators of all time, and that's why he does it all the time.
And he's smooth and consistent. A little acknowledgement there in the background. He really values the championship too, Jamie. He's one of the guys that feels the championship is a complex animal to master. Though he appreciates the Bathurst victories, it's the championship that means most to him. This battle continues. Todd Kelly, position 5. Scott McLaughlin, 6. And then Michael Caruso is 7th. Then Rick Kelly, followed by Chaz Mostert. Not much between these fellas.
Oh, Todd. Ooh, that was close. He was almost off the road. He had to light the brake pedal up again, mid-corner. That's the road falls away. It doesn't, it's hard to pick it up there. So the camber's off. Todd ran in there, ran too wide, and he actually had to brake the car in the middle of the corner, slow it down, and get it back for the second apex. So Todd now has got to hang on, because we saw Lowndes put all this pressure on McLaughlin in the previous race. McLaughlin is now the antagonist. Down the inside, he almost gets the Volvo down the inside at Siberia. Todd, with that late apex and that massively different racing line, almost gave McLaughlin an invitation to get down the inside based on that. And what also happens here, I was trying to explain it before, that when you're the car behind, when you move around, you interrupt the air over the rear wing of the car in front. So it does tend to destabilize that car. Into turn one is one of the favorite spots you do it. You're right in behind, you shift the car, it shifts the air, and it destabilises the car in front. So that was also a spot just then that you saw going up into the hay shed where McLaughlin was very close to doing the same thing. So on the final lap, now with Jamie Whincup in a commanding position, 461-point lead. This could be the day, right now, with three quarters of a lap to go, that this man wins 6 championships, a record never achieved.
And in doing so, if he nails this, and he's certainly on target, it's 12 victories for him in 2014, and there's still races to come in Sydney. He potentially becomes champion-elect. The reason why he isn't officially crowned here is you can be docked points and there can be issues arising in Sydney. So it'll be a somewhat muted celebration, but it's still an important one for Red Bull Racing Australia, for Holden and for all of those attached to this outfit. In 2008, he won a record 15 races in the season, and we did a little feature story on him earlier in the day about all of the things that he's achieved. Remember, he's moved his pole number on. He's already number one in that world to 60. 132 podiums. He's sitting on win 86. This will be win 87. And Australian motorsport will applaud this man, Jamie Whincup, today. He goes into the record book. That is an emotional and extraordinary achievement. Jamie Whincup is champion-elect. 6 V8 supercar victories. 4 championships on the trot. Paul Dumbrella, who helped him on his way with victories at Sandown and the Gold Coast. And this man now owns a very special place in the history of the sport.
Just going to try and grab a word with Roland Ain, given Dave Coutier, a well-deserved hug there. That's good stuff, you know, it's championship. Hey, Roland, I can see this one means a lot to you. 6 championships with Jamie. He had to work hard for this one. He had to come from behind. Where's this one ranked for you, mate? It's pretty special. Cheers. It is, mate. I can see. Right, you don't have to say anything. There you are. You don't see that guy tear up too much.
Yeah, that's exactly the reaction. But, Larko, that emotion from Roland Dane describes... And there's Ludo and all the other guys there. Jeremy, Dave Couchy was the one that was in the embrace with Roland. It's a great group of people and they thoroughly deserve the rewards, Larko.
Couchy, I've got Dave Couchy. Let me shake your hand, pal. Not only a smart guy, a really good bloke on pit lane, Couchy. Some tough elements to this year, but you've pulled through, got a championship together with Jamie. I mean, that must mean so much to you and your future.
Yeah, mate, it was, like you said, it wasn't an easy year. It was very difficult, particularly the start, working with a driver as good as Jamie, with a team as good as these guys. There's obviously a lot of expectation, but, yeah, mate, with a team like this and a driver like that, that's what you get. They're awesome.
Can I say, mate, I've watched it this year. I mean, Dutto's boots were a big set to step into, but you've done it with conviction, mate. You've stayed the course. Well done, an outstanding effort, mate. I mean it. Well done.
Thank you, mate. Cheers. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a big effort. And he would have had a huge amount of pressure on him as a young engineer. to take that position in the team, to make the right calls, because the world's watching, the team's watching. The wrong calls are going to be amplified. Everybody will jump on you. Started out very well for him in Adelaide at the Clipsal 500. Very strong in Tasmania at the second event, but he fell in holes at Winton, northeastern Victoria, at Pukekohe in New Zealand, and again in Western Australia by his standards. He was still getting results, but not by the standards that we know of this man. He went away, he took a break, he had to think about it, upped his game. He came back, and from Darwin onwards, he snatched back the authority in this championship from Mark Winterbottom, and now he's champion-elect. Six championships, Jamie Wincup.
Great camaraderie.
Washes away all that stress at Bathurst, where 20 seconds from home he was on for the win and ended up finishing in fifth place. We'll have a word with him once he's composed and got his gear off. Let's get down there.
Jamie Wincup, outstanding. Congratulations. It's never been done before, although it's not 100% official yet, but six times champion. Brilliant work.
Thanks, Brett. Yes, it's all a bit emotional down here, as you could imagine. As I said, on the grid, though, there's plenty of pride on the line from here to the end. So, I think points-wise it's all done. We'll keep our head down and make sure we finish off the year as well as we possibly can. But that trophy's going to be pretty sweet come the end of the year.
Neil and Scafie mentioned it earlier, how much championships mean to you. Having won six of them now, tell us about the pressure coming into this round this weekend, knowing that you could get it done.
There's no more pressure than what I put on myself, and just proud of the collective group. There's a lot of probably 95% of the group here that has been involved in the whole six championships. So they gave me another rocket today. A bit of a fairy tale, really, to win the race, to win the championship is good. Similar to the Gold Coast for the Enduro Cup, but as I said, there's still plenty to go. You know, I'm focused on tomorrow. I'm focused on Sydney. But as I say, once we get there, it's going to be pretty sweet.
And you effectively exceed the greatest names in the sport, the Dick Johnsons, the Mark Scaifes. How does that sit with you?
Yeah, as I say, the numbers are one thing. I'm sure they're going to mean a hell of a lot when I hang the helmet up. Hopefully not for a long time yet. But I'm sure those numbers will mean absolutely everything to me. But right now, I'm in the heat of the battle. Never loved my motorsport more than I have right now. And to be honest, I just can't wait to get out there tomorrow and have another crack.
We can't wait to see you, Jamie. Congratulations.
That's right, Jeff. Thanks.
All right, Craig Lowndes finishing in second spot and doing great things for his championship. Lowndesy, that's great. I mean, so many good things today. Great to see your teammate effectively wrap up the championship. You move up the ladder after today. It's been a good day.
Oh, look, it's been a great day, Barrett. I think that the main focus for the team was obviously to clinch that championship. Jamie did a great job. You know, he was going to be hard to beat that race. I think that, we pushed him all the way to the end. And of course, you know, he's well deserved. He's had a fantastic season. Great for the team, you know, to have a 1-2. And obviously to win a championship on a win, I think is also a credit to him, as obviously he shows his credibility and obviously his commitment to what he wants to do. But yeah, look, we've had a great run today. We've moved, I think, third in the championship. We're closing the points to Frosty, but look, we'll see you. We'll keep fighting on tomorrow and see what we can do.
Yeah, big day. Rest up tonight. Have a good one tomorrow, Lowndesy. See you there.
I will. Say hello to Levi and Chili.
See you later. Good work, Lowndesy. Hey, Frosty. Boy, tough day. Always hard in combat with these guys. The good news is you're holding on to second spot in the championship. Can you get a stranglehold on that by the end of tomorrow?
Oh, man, that was like 23 qualifying laps. So these two cars are too quick. We're pretty well the best of the rest. You know, Garth was definitely quicker, but he just tapped. I don't know. You just we need to go back and have a look. But, you know, we're having a pretty rough time. But to stand up, spray champagne and stuff, still a good day. So got plenty of grass from race one and a bit of trophy from race two. So that's not too bad.
See you on the podium. Well done, Frosty.
Thanks, buddy.
Right, I've managed to grab these couple of blokes again. You've composed yourself, mate. So let me ask you the question, because I am keen to get the answer. Yep. Everyone is. Yep. What does this one mean to you, mate?
It's pretty cool, because the level of competition keeps increasing. And it's just this year we've had a fight back again from a little bit of a lean spell. And the competition level is so intense now. I mean, you saw out there, there's the Nissans, the Volvos, as well as the Fords, all giving us a run for our money. So to come out on top again is just a testament to the amount of work that these guys do. And Dotto's been able to take his P-plates off now. And I might give him the keys.
Yeah, we'd like seeing you at the headsets. Well done, Dotto. I've got to shake your hand, mate. You've stepped up to the plate this year, mate. It has been hard. There was a point in the year where you didn't look like you were perhaps going to win the championship. What was the turning point for you? Or what turned it?
Nothing, no magic. Just working hard, just everyone just grouping together. Engineers working together, mechanics working together. Just a big team effort to step up. We're finals players. So when the chips are down, we dig deep and we come through.
So focus on a 1-2 now at Sydney, I guess, huh?
That's the plan, definitely.
Why aren't I surprised? Anyway, heads down, back to work, boys.
Well, that's a very big afternoon of motorsport and a big result for Jamie Wincup. 3.5 seconds, the official gap in the end between he and his teammate Craig Lowndes. Mark Winterbottom, as he said, gets a trophy, gets to spray champagne, but doesn't grab the championship this year. Several drivers making a clawback through the field, including Coulthard and Shane Van Gisbergen. Still a lot of racing to come. Big race tomorrow and then 3 races in Sydney. The podium is now set. Here's Barrett's.
Our 34th race of the year, introducing the winning drivers. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please congratulate in first place for Red Bull Racing Australia, Jamie Wincup. In second place, Red Bull Racing Australia's Craig Lowndes. And in third place for Ford Pepsi Max crew, please congratulate Mark Winterbottom. Representing the winning team at Red Bull Racing Australia, Mark Dutton. Making the presentation of our third place trophy is Amy Dory, General Manager, our naming rights sponsor, Plus Fitness. Presenting to second place is Nigel Miller, Managing Director of Plus Fitness. Making the presentation to our winning team is Claudia Larson, Sponsorship Manager, United Petroleum. And making the presentation of the first place trophy is John Fuller, the Chief Executive Officer of Plus Fitness. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2014 V8 Supercars Plus Fitness Phillip Island 400 Race 34 winners.
And they are Jamie Wincup, Craig Lowndes, and Mark Winterbottom, Holden, and Ford.